Maverick's got some pretty specific taste when it comes to his ladies and the cars they drive. Did you feel stirrings of a new hope while watching Top Gun Maverick? And hey, whatever happened to bonding through a volleyball game? These are the small details you missed in Top Gun Maverick. Director of the original Top Gun, Tony Scott, died by suicide in 2012. At the time, a script for a Top Gun sequel was in development, but the project was shelved after Scott's death. The eventual director of Top Gun Maverick, Joseph Kosinski, decided to faithfully recreate the 1986 film's opening sequence as a tip of the hat to Scott's previous excellent work. The first scene will feel familiar to anyone who's seen Top Gun. First up is a black and white title card. Then, silhouettes of crew members ready a plane for takeoff as the Grammy Award-winning Top Gun anthem gives way to the guitar riffs of Kenny Loggins' Danger Zone. The only differences come in the way of some of the actors and the planes. In the original, Maverick flew an F-14. This time, he's test-piloting a fictional craft called the Dark Star that looks to be inspired by an SR-71 Blackbird. Kosinski explained to Entertainment Weekly, "I wanted that first few minutes to just tell you, this is a Top Gun movie. We love it as much as you do." He also credited Scott with inventing not only the visual style of the first Top Gun, but of the modern action movie, and Kosinski wanted to pay tribute to him. In Top Gun Maverick, everything old is new again. When Maverick gets shipped off to the Naval Air Station North Island, where he'll serve as an instructor instead of a test pilot, he reaches for his old aviator sunglasses, helmet, jacket, and motorcycle. Sharp-eyed fans of the original will recall the costume pieces and the Kawasaki Ninja motorcycle from 1986's Top Gun. These aren't just Easter eggs for the sake of fan service. In the film, it's clear that some of Maverick's compatriots resent him because he doesn't seem to have matured and he hasn't advanced in his career. Many pilots Maverick's junior now outrank him, as he's still a captain after more than 30 years.
You should be at least a two-star admiral by now. Yet here you are.
The fact that Pete Mitchell still wears the same gear and rides the same bike, or at least the same make, is a symbolic reflection of the fact that he's kind of stuck in the 80s too. Kelly McGillis, who played instructor Charlie Blackwood in Top Gun, didn't return for the sequel. That meant Maverick needed a new love interest in the film. But rather than create a character out of thin air, filmmakers decided to bring to life an old reference. Jennifer Connelly is Penny Benjamin in Top Gun Maverick, a single mom and owner of the Hard Deck Bar with whom Maverick appears to have had past entanglements. Their relationship gets a fleeting mention in an early scene of Top Gun.
With a history of high-speed passes over five air-controlled towers and one admiral's daughter.
Penny Benjamin.
Penny is the admiral's daughter in question. Goose drops her name in the original and adds that her dad went ballistic over their fling, which would have predated Maverick's time spent with Charlie. Since we don't see or hear how exactly Charlie and Pete's romance fizzled out, we're left to conclude from Penny's comments that Maverick has trouble committing. She talks about their history as if they've been on and off again several times for several decades, and the way her daughter, Amelia, treats Maverick suggests he's hurt her mother more than once. In many ways, Top Gun Maverick is more like a remix of Top Gun than a sequel. Since the follow-up takes place a full generation later, there's a satisfying thematic resonance to seeing similar scenes play out with slightly altered outcomes. One such scene occurs when Maverick visits the hard deck and attempts to flirt with Penny. When he disrespects her, she rings a bell and announces to the patrons that the next round is on Maverick. When he can't pay, he's disrespected and thrown out of the building. The next morning, Hangman and the others arrive for training to find that the man they mocked and threw out on the street the night before is actually their instructor. This entire sequence is a reference to the bar scene in Top Gun, but with the roles switched. Hangman is now the cocksure youngster, Rooster is the stand-in for Goose, and Maverick has replaced his old flame Charlie as the incognito teacher. It's no secret that the United States Navy played nice with the cast and crew of both Top Gun and Top Gun Maverick, giving them unprecedented access to equipment because they saw the movies as potential recruitment tools for prospective pilots. It worked the first time. Enrollment went up 500% after Top Gun hit theaters, and the branch is hoping for another boost in response to the sequel. While what's now the Top Gun franchise is unabashedly patriotic, it's not really against a specific enemy country. In fact, the enemy is never actually identified in either one. This time, the anonymous bad guys are on the wrong side of NATO, enriching uranium for a nuclear weapon in treacherous, snowy mountain terrain. They fly fifth-generation fighters that are superior to their own planes, making the mission even more dangerous. Critics, fans, and geopolitical experts have made educated guesses as to which country is the aggressor. Russia and China have fifth-generation fighters and snowy mountains, but they also already have nukes. North Korea and Iran are in similar stages of weapons development, but don't have the aircraft in question. And escalation with any of these nations would likely plunge the world into war. It's probably best to think of the enemy as a purely fictional country. In addition to Cruise, Val Kilmer reprises his role as Tom Iceman Kazansky. The film implies that he and Maverick stayed close after the harrowing finale of Top Gun, but that Iceman rose through the ranks to become a four-star admiral and commander of the Pacific Fleet, while Maverick remained stuck at the rank of captain. When Maverick and Iceman finally reunite on camera, it's obvious he's not well. Iceman's wife tells Pete that it hurts him even to speak. The former Flyboys have a touching reunion, and before the final mission, Maverick gets the call. Iceman has succumbed to his illness. In real life, Val Kilmer has been battling throat cancer since 2017. The veteran actor lost his voice as a result. Cruise couldn't imagine a Top Gun sequel without his friend, so he convinced him to participate, and the character's arc was written to be respectful to both Iceman's legacy and Kilmer's situation. The character's voice is a combination of Kilmer's sons, spliced with previous recordings of the actor. In the first Top Gun, the cadets learn the value of teamwork with a volleyball game. Director Tony Scott got himself in hot water for the scene, which was only a short paragraph in the script. Paramount was so angry that Scott spent a day's time and money on the volleyball game that they considered firing him. In the end, the volleyball interlude became one of the most iconic moments in the movie.
And I didn't have a vision about what I was doing other than just doing soft porn.
In Top Gun Maverick, Cyclone tells Mav to assemble a team, but as the mission date gets moved up, he's frustrated by the cadets' progress. Rather than devote more hours to practicing their route, he challenges his squad to a friendly but spirited game of dogfight football. He explains it's the same as regular beach football, but with both sides' offense and defense running at the same time. While the sport has changed, the scene is a clear allusion to the original Top Gun and another acknowledgement of Tony Scott's influence. Another memorable moment from 1986's Top Gun comes at the end of Maverick's first training hop in Miramar. The young hotshot pilot manages to defeat his trainer, Jester, but he flies below the hard deck and breaks the rules of engagement to do so. His superiors admire his skill but admonish him for his recklessness. The Pete Mitchell we see in Top Gun Maverick is about 35 years older and at least a little wiser, but he still can't help himself from throwing caution to the wind. In the film's gripping opening scene, Maverick pushes the experimental Darkstar plane past its limits, reaching the elusive milestone of Mach 10, but destroying the expensive piece of government equipment in the process. He pulls a similar stunt when Cyclone is about to send his still unprepared cadets into enemy territory. Phoenix doubts that the mission is even possible, but Maverick completes it without crashing or getting shot down by simulators with less than a second to spare. Afterward, he buzzes the tower, just like he did 35 years earlier.
All right, that was awesome.
Pete Mitchell really has a thing for women who have a thing for Porsches. In Top Gun, his instructor and the object of his affection could be seen behind the wheel of a black 1958 Porsche 356. That vehicle was actually a replica, made especially for the film by a Canadian company called Intermechanica. In Top Gun Maverick, bar owner and on-and-off girlfriend Penny drives a 1973 Porsche 911S. This time, filmmakers were able to secure the real thing. Car collector Nick Sillos lent his to the production, and a Model E was kept on set as a backup. Director Joseph Kaczynski told Fortune magazine, "Penny sails fast boats, so I liked the idea that she drove a vintage Porsche as well." Jennifer Connelly operated the vehicle herself during the shoot. Business at the hard deck must be good. A mint condition 1973 Porsche 911S can go for more than $200,000. Star Wars fans who went to theaters over Memorial Day weekend to see Top Gun Maverick may have noticed some curious parallels between Maverick and Company's mission to explode the uranium target and Luke Skywalker's heroic effort to destroy the Death Star. Maverick is trying to prepare his team for a job that'll require two miracles to pull off. First, they must fly low through an icy cavern full of switchbacks guarded by defense missile turrets. Then, they must hit their target twice before escaping. In Star Wars: A New Hope, Luke Skywalker and his fellow X-Wing pilots have to fly their spacecraft through the Death Star's labyrinth-like trenches until they reach their equally tiny target, a thermal exhaust port which they have but one chance to hit with a proton torpedo. And when Maverick and Rooster are shot down and ejected into the wilderness, Hangman comes to their rescue at the last second in much the same way Han Solo did for the Rebels. Top Gun Maverick isn't a shot-for-shot and word-for-word remake of the original, but in addition to several sequences that closely mirror those of the first film, several lines of dialogue are referenced or exactly repeated. These don't feel like lazy writing choices. They're callbacks to significant moments and lessons learned from Maverick's younger days at Top Gun. Among the words of wisdom, Maverick tells Rooster, "Don't think, just do." This sentiment, which gets uttered a few times throughout the movie, comes from Maverick's Top Gun advice.
The MiG has you in his gun sight. What were you thinking at this point?
You don't have time to think up there.
If you think, you're dead.
Maverick's line, "Too close for missiles, switching to guns," is also a close copy, as are mentions about not dropping your wingman. One of the cadets who makes Maverick's team, Payback, repeats the phrase, "turn and burn," from the original. Of course, they might not all be intentional references. After all, it would be impossible not to retread some of the words and sayings that Top Gun made famous, since terms like hard deck are used by real aviators every day. Check out one of our newest videos right here. Plus, even more Looper videos about your favorite movies are coming soon. Subscribe to our YouTube channel and hit the bell so you don't miss a single one.